Hello and welcome to the Initiative on Catholic Social Thought and Public Life, our dialogue on faith and the faithful in a time of national crisis and new leadership. We're delighted you've joined us. Many people have, more than 2,000 people signed up. I think that's because we're at an unprecedented moment. Last week, the U.S. Capitol was attacked by a violent mob, and the images are burned into our souls. Weapons, Confederate flags, Jesus saves, as they threatened our leaders and the democracy itself. Yesterday, President Trump was impeached at that same Capitol for his incitement of that action. And next week, again at the Capitol, unless they change it, we will watch the inauguration of the second Catholic president in U.S. history and the first woman vice president, first African-American, first Asian-American vice president. It's just been a stunning moment in our history. And our faith gives us a way to look at this, to understand this, to act upon it, to own it, to be responsible for it. In my church, we're called to read the signs of the times. All of us as Christians are called to be salt, light, and leaven in our own lives and in our democracy. So, but we carry out these tasks in the midst of violence and attacks on democracy itself, in the middle of an ongoing pandemic, an economic crisis, which touches us all, but especially communities of color, and a racial reckoning and bitter divisions in our nation. And we now will have next week a new administration and a new Congress to lead us in that. So we have assembled a group of respected leaders, a journalist and four religious leaders, to ask what are the principles of faith which should guide us? What are the obligations and opportunities of the faithful as we assess what has happened and how we move ahead? How are we to be one nation under God with liberty and justice for all? And we have pulled together, I think, a unique group. I hope no one will take offense at this, but we have two Washington institutions. Jerry Seib has been a leader at the Wall Street Journal for decades. He's been executive editor. He writes the Washington column. He's in many ways the dean of journalists who cover the White House. Barbara Williams, Skinner Williams, for decades has been a voice of conscience, a leader of the Black Church, and someone who connects faith here in Washington. So we have two veterans. We have two new leaders who have assumed new responsibilities. Reverend Eugene Cho is the new president of Bread for the World, which, as you know, works on hunger and poverty, very much involved in the Circle of Protection. And Adam Taylor is the new president of Sojourners, which is a leading voice in the evangelical community and beyond, the entire religious community. And I'll say more about them later. And I'm especially glad the woman who wins the door prize for phoning in from the greatest distance is Kathleen Domingo, all the way from Los Angeles. Kathleen tries to bring together, she's a Catholic laywoman, works for the largest diocese, Catholic diocese in the country, Los Angeles, and the president of the Bishops' Conference, and she tries to bring together pro-life and social justice Catholics to work for the common good. So we're going to ask them, how do these diverse parts of the Christian community assess our responsibilities in this current crisis? How do we explore how to lift up the least of these? How do we work with a new administration and advance the common good and maybe even some healing? And how have the politics changed, and how does that change religious advocacy? 10 days ago, Georgia sent to the U.S. Senate a Jewish alumnus of Georgetown and an African-American preacher from Dr. King's church. And the control of the Senate passed to the Democrats, and it's like we hardly notice because of all that's going on. What is different, and how does that change our responsibilities? How will faith in the faithful shape the agendas and actions of the Biden-Harris administration and this new Congress? So I'm first going to turn to Jerry Seib. Jerry, as you know, is executive Washington editor for the Wall Street Journal. He has received awards for every kind of journalism, covering the president, covering the White House, covering the Iraq War. He was part of the team that got the Pulitzer for covering 9/11. He is, in my experience, one of the most thoughtful, balanced, and insightful journalists in Washington. And we thought, who could set the context? Who could summarize where we are and what it might mean? So, Jerry, the first question is really basic. Have you ever seen anything like this? What has happened and what does it mean? And then I want to go on and I'll ask you about what's it mean for elected leaders, but also religious leaders and believers. But first, give us some context. What has happened and what are its implications?
Sure. First of all, thanks for convening this. This feels like a week in which an intelligent conversation is more needed than ever. So I'm grateful for the chance to have one. First of all, there's no comparison. Nothing like this has ever happened, not just in our lifetimes, but in American history. So that's the backdrop here. And I was trying to think this week, what could you compare it to go to your question? And I can only think of two things. This must be a little bit like what it felt after the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, when people were wondering, how deep does this run? How wide is the network? How much in peril are our institutions? And then after 9/11, which was another time in all our memories in which it just seemed as if the unthinkable had just happened. And by the way, to complete the backdrop, you forgot one thing, John, which is that in the midst of all this, this week, we also hit a single day high of coronavirus deaths on top of everything else. So can you compare that to anything? No, I can't anyway. And I think it's important to step back and look at what happened briefly again first. You kind of summarized it, but let me take it a little bit further. So this wasn't a protest that went bad, a political march that went bad. This was the president of the United States sending thousands and thousands of his supporters to the Capitol to try to overturn the results of the election. That would have been pretty shocking if that's all it was. If it had been a peaceful march, it was still an attempt to stop the peaceful transfer of power, because the transfer would not have happened if this march had succeeded. But it did turn violent. And the more we know about it, the worse it sounds. This is a mob that broke through the barriers to the Capitol, obviously. They killed a policeman by hitting him on the head with a fire extinguisher. They marched through the halls of Congress looking for leaders, saying the vice president should be hung, trying to break down doors to reach Nancy Pelosi. They broke windows, and they sent staff members of the House Speaker cowering under a table for 2 hours while they tried to break down the doors to get to them. There's every reason to think there were two pipe bombs planted nearby that were designed to be a diversion to draw law enforcement away from the site of the attack. This was serious, serious stuff. And the more we know, the worse it gets. And I think the implications are pretty obvious and they're pretty enormous. I think one of the implications is it probably means it's less likely in the long run Donald Trump is seen as the legitimate leader of the Republican Party. I think the Republican Party is in flames and split down the middle. I think Democrats have some difficult questions to raise, whether they're going to try to be conciliatory here in this environment or not. But I think the biggest question, John, and I'll stop this answer here, is what has it done to the country? What has it shown us about how deep this division really is? And, I was thinking about why are we so shocked? And a wonderful priest, the parochial vicar of Blessed Sacrament Parish, our home parish, gave a marvelous homily on Sunday trying to put some of this into words. And he said something that I think explains why this is so shocking to us on a personal level. He said, "We feel overwhelmed and violated. Things so sacred to all of us, whatever our persuasion, got desecrated. Evil oppressed us and seemed to have conquered us for some time." So that's, I think, what the day felt like and the day since have felt like. But I also would note that in spite of all that, and at the same time that president was being impeached, mostly by Democrats in the House, there was a Axios poll that came out today that said 63% of Republicans approve of President Trump's recent actions. And these are actions since this happened. 92% of Trump supporters said they want him to run again in 2024. And 41% of traditional Republicans say they also would vote for him if he ran again in 2024. So this is a very, very deep and troubling divide.
Thank you, Jerry. It's worth remembering that a lot of those people who were marching through those halls looking for our leaders were Christians. A lot of the people who answered that poll are believers. Let me ask a two-part question. One, what do our political leaders need to do at a moment like this? We can't seem to vaccinate people. We can't seem to protect the country from hackers. We can't protect the Capitol. The inauguration is under siege. What are the responsibilities of elected leaders? And then, as you said, you're a believer from your pew on at Blessed Sacrament. When you're listening to that homily, what do you think religious leaders, what should people of faith do? And if you want to add a third, what should journalists do? Yeah. So in light of all this, what do our leaders need to do? What do people of faith need to do? And if you're up to it, what do journalists need to do?
Well, I you know, the one thing that strikes me is that we keep looking and have looked for 5 years or more, maybe, at for the event that would bring the country together, that would cause people to step back in shock and horror and say, now we need to cool it. Now we need to stop going down this path and choose another path. And there was a time immediately after this happened last week where I thought this might be that event. But the numbers I just cited in terms of poll findings and what we saw yesterday suggest that's not it. So this event will not in and of itself kind of cause people to step back and find a saner path forward. That is the task of leadership now, I think. And I would just suggest that, and this is, sounds like a cliche, but what people in Congress need to do is figure out a way to do some things together. And I would suggest, and the reason I mentioned the coronavirus at the outset, is that that's the one place where I think the new president and the new Congress can go right away to show that they can get something done. And they need to set some of this aside. You know, people have to decide whether the priority here is justice against the president for what he did to make this happen, or if the priority is conciliation, or can those two things live together? But there has to be, some people have to emerge in Congress. I would say, I think that this may be a moment uniquely suited for Joe Biden. You know, his kind of hokey, what seemed hokey at the time he announced his candidacy. I'm the kind of guy who can bring people together. I'm the guy who can work across party lines. We have to get past this moment. We have to be stop being so divisive. Some people almost mocked him for that, saying you don't understand the tenor of the times. And Joe Biden is not a perfect person. None of us are. He's got plenty of flaws. But this might be a moment, I would say, in which he is uniquely suited in our current political establishment and our current political firmament to actually try to do that. That is his trademark. It's what he said he wanted to do. He happens to arrive at a moment when that's needed more than ever. So that's what I would say the political system can do. In terms of Americans more broadly, I think the one thing you can't do is withdraw. You know, there is a tendency, I think, to be in such shock and horror that you simply pull away, you disengage from the political system. That's what I think well-meaning people can't do. You have to stay in that conversation and you have to have civilized conversations in your own circle. This is hard. I mean, there are people in my own family who have a quite different view of what happened here this week than I do, you know, but, and the temptation is to lock horns and argue about that. I think that's what people can't do. I think everybody has to take a deep breath and not be part of the problem, be part of the solution, and don't rise to the bait, because in a million ways that can happen around the country. It can't happen now. And third, in terms of journalists, I wish I had a better answer. I think all we can do is seek truth. I mean, not shy away. And if you read my emails, you would know that I got one last night. I'll just mention it here. Somebody said, why don't you say the truth that Antifa was behind the mob, that they were in the mob that descended on the Capitol? And all you can say to such a person is, that is simply not true. You want me to speak the truth, I will speak the truth to you. That's not what happened. Kellyanne Conway, of all people, tweeted out something this week that said, don't turn your eyes away. Don't make excuses. This is even worse than it looked at the time. And if Kellyanne Conway is saying that, I think we all have to be honest with ourselves. And my role as a journalist is just to be honest about what really happened and what the implications are. Don't shy away from it. Expect to be attacked for doing that, and try to carry on.
Thank you for that powerful overview, Jerry, and for being with us today when so much else is going on. One column I saw, and it sort of summarized what you said. A single day shakes two presidencies, two parties, and one nation to the core. How has this moment shaken the Christian church? What is, as we look back, as we look ahead, what is the mission, the message of the Christian community at this time of testing? I would like to ask each of our other panelists to just give a brief summary. What is the essence of our mission and message today? And let me begin with Barbara.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Jerry. The mission is the same as it's always been. It is to live at the core of what Jesus taught, that love trumps hate, excuse the pun, that we are called to care for the least of these without respect of person. And if there's anything that's challenged us in the last week, it is how far away from that we've gone as a people. Even in our discourse with one another, whether it's public or whatever, we've gone from just disagreeing to literally demonize. And I think the mission is to see the humanity in every person, no matter what their politics, power, or whatever. And I think the other aspect of our mission is some self-reflection on our own complicity in the state of where we are right now. The fact that many pro-Trump Christians saw their engagement, the mob action, as a holy war, and that others of us sat aghast in horror, is the where, as Jerry just said, that's where the country is. It's a major divide. So the question is, are we at a point where we can say, I want to be a peacemaker? And, you know, I don't want to be part of the problem. I think that's the issue of our mission has got to be making peace and not division. That's what I believe. It is not demonizing. It's not devaluing. My friends laugh at me for praying for the president, who I totally disagree with on almost everything, because it is my Christian duty, because he is in authority and God allowed that. So I'm just saying our mission is to go back to basics.
Thank you.
And to interrogate where we are and how we can come back to being part of the solution and not the problem as we seem to be right now.
Thank you, that's powerful. Eugene, before you were president of Bread for the World, your pastor, what's the fundamental mission and message of Christians at this moment of testing?
Well, thank you again for having me, and it's a privilege to be here with the other guests. I want to just echo everything that's been shared, and especially with what Barbara shared. Our mission hasn't changed. For the past 2,000 years, as Jesus descended here on earth and giving us this call to love God and to love people, those are the two great commandments. I'm reminded that when we're called to love people, we're not just called to love those that look like me, think like me, feel like me, worship like me. And I think we should even acknowledge those that would vote like me. These are really challenging, challenging things to do. But following Jesus is a challenge. One of the most painful images that I think we saw as religious leaders in the past week, there were so many, and Jerry went on a litany of the painful images that we saw. But seeing sacred phrases that are very dear and important to us as followers of Jesus being hijacked and used in the mob was particularly very painful. for so many of us. So during this time, I would encourage us to think about a few things. Number one is that we need to lament. And by lament, I'm not talking about a 15-minute prayer service and then on we go to the next thing. We should be broken in our soul for what we've witnessed and sit in that lament. And I think as we sit in that lament, it gives us a deeper glimpse of God's heart, of how God mourns over what's been passing in our nation and around the world with the riots, with COVID, with the high rates of hunger, and the list goes on. The last thing that I'll just say is that, and I'm sure we'll have this conversation, is what does unity look like? A divided nation, the answer to a divided nation is not a divided church. And that's what we're seeing because we have such radically different understandings of what's transpired.
Thank you. Not a divided church. Kathleen, you're on the front lines in some ways, but all the way across the country. What is our mission, our message in light of what we've been through?
So I think along with Barbara and Eugene, the first thing I would say is we need to do an examination of conscience. Pope Francis talks about this a lot, and I think our spiritual leaders talk about it. A personal examination of conscience, also sort of a more global examination of conscience. What have each of us individually done? We've seen play out in real time the damage that social media has done. We know that we have had pastors and spiritual leaders who have come out very vehemently on either side during this campaign season, and that has done damage. So I think that first of all, that personal examination of conscience. The second thing I would suggest is personal conversion. If we're asking our leaders to examine themselves and to make some changes, I think first we have to recognize that cultural change and cultural transformation starts with personal conversion. So I would definitely, I love how Jerry said, don't shy away from the truth. We have to look at ourselves and say, what have I done and what do I need to do? And I think the final thing is there's a choice to be made. In our Catholic tradition, in our Christian tradition, in the scriptures, we see a couple of different examples of how to be a person of faith in a diverse world. We can be the person who stands out in the desert and who shouts and yells at the sinner and who points out the sin and who decries the sin. And that's an important person to be. Or we can choose to be the person who rolls up their sleeves in humility and sits down like Jesus did with the sinner and says, what am I going to do? How can we get to work? How can we come together? How can we solve this? And that takes a certain amount of humility. And I don't think you can be both. I think we need both. But I think it's really important to determine who do you want to be and what in this moment are you willing to do?
Adam, you've been working at this a long time. You've assumed this great new responsibility. What's our mission? What's our message?
Yeah, thanks, John. Grateful to be with you and with all the other panelists. Couldn't agree more with what's been shared. I would just add to one of the things that Eugene mentioned, that our mission hasn't changed, and it's to love God and love each other. It's also to love creation. And I think what we saw this last week showed how the kind of politics of division that I think, unfortunately, President Trump has been the grand entrepreneur of, posed an existential threat to our democracy. We also know that climate change and environmental racism poses an existential threat to communities and to our planet as a whole. So I'd want to emphasize that additional dimension of how we love. I think at the core of our Christian vocation is to restore right relationship. And we know just how broken and marred our relationships are. And so I would just add two things. One is that we have to find ways to transform our severely broken politics from what I just described as a politics of division, which has been fueled by what Howard Thurman, the great mystic and theologian, described as the three hounds of hell that track the disinherited, which are fear, hypocrisy, and hatred. And unfortunately, Trump exercised and played with those three hounds quite significantly. And it's not, you know, simply just a matter of Trump, of course. This has been a part of our body politic for a very long time. But I think we have to be more courageous in being willing to name those three hounds, and we have to be willing to combat them. The other dynamic is there's incentives within our political system that have become extremely perverted, that are rewarding a politics of division, that play with an us versus them mentality, a kind of zero sum mentality. These are, you know, trends like gerrymandered districts and the overinfluence of money in our politics and others that also need to be transformed. We need to be able to reward a politics of the common good and have that overcome the politics of division. Fortunately, in Christ, we have a shared identity and a shared set of values that I think are an incredible antidote to many of the challenges that we face. But it's going to take some real courageous relationship building and courageous work together to be able to see a politics of the common good ultimately prevail.
Thank you. That's a very powerful charge. Let me come back to Barbara, if I could. I think many people know you, but lots of people on this call don't. For decades, you have been a bridge builder. You have been a truth teller. You have reminded me and others of the, with some frequency, that racism is the fundamental test for American Christianity, along with fidelity. You started the African American Clergy Network. You and your husband, Tom, started the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation Prayer Breakfast. When I first met you, you were executive director of the Congressional Black Caucus, and I think there were 13 members at that point, and now there are 42. So there is some hope. I want to ask two questions. One, the Black church has been in the middle of everything this year in terms of turnout, in terms of voter suppression, in terms of speaking up. When the country saw the racism in our streets, the Black church said, there's racism in our structures and in our churches. And so during the election, the national election and the election in Georgia, the Black church was both attacked and also empowered. The second, so how should white Christians be listening to our African-American brothers and sisters in the Christian family of faith? And then secondly, where do we, in fact, build some bridges? Where, that's the first question, but where was racism last Wednesday? Where is grace today? How do we find sin and overcome it? And how do we discover grace and build on it? So what should we be learning and listening? Where is the sin? Where is the grace? And how do we overcome this?
Thank you. One thing I felt immediately after watching last week with such horror as the rest of you is that the fear that African-Americans have always felt, the trauma we feel every day, fear of being over-policed, our bodies weaponized, whether we're middle class or poor. I think Americans feel some of that fear. I'm not happy about that, but it is real. What the Black church has really spoken into since the beginning, before even in slavery ended, and then after Reconstruction, is that we have a national identity crisis. We have a crisis of who we are as a nation. On the one hand, a white nation for white people aggrieved by the interloping, advancement, engagement of non-white people. On the other, we have this notion about a nation under God. That if Jerry talked about truth, unless we engage the truth about that gap, then I don't know how we get back to what Adam called courageous reconnection or courageous building of bridges. And so it was really the President Obama who talked at the Selma March about 5 years ago when he said that our union is not perfect, but the what the Black church constantly talks about, this is that the real threat to America is not Russia, Iran, it's not China, it's not North Korea. It is the implosion from within of that original sin of devaluing some lives and lifting up others, and then lying about it, covering it up, or acting as if it did not even exist, when every system in the country, religious, banking, military, education, whatever, cultural, all have this lifting up and privileging of whites and disadvantaging Blacks. The Black church has been the fulcrum against that. It has been the sanctuary for people of color, of Black people for sure, to run from a world that totally believes you should not even either not be here, or if you're here, please don't advance above white people. And so it's a place where leadership, Dr. Martin Luther King, Andrew Young, others could develop in a world that says you can't be a leader in our institution. It's a place where kids would go bad, but they would have a chance because of that community. It is where resiliency through the gospel messages, the redeeming love of God, the Exodus story that Black churches have always kind of bought into and preached about, a people who always have a God who show them a way out. Saying the Black church, though it may be weaker today than it has been, like most churches, is still the main place and the main strength of our Black people. And the election showed that. I'm not saying everybody, 56% at least of most of Black people, according to the studies, are still very much connected to the church, okay? The election would not have been won, neither in Georgia, nor in the states that we worked in, without the power of the Black church. Didn't have all the money, didn't have all of the infrastructure and strategy, but it was that resolve that God is always going to show us a way out. If we work together, we're going to make it, and that we have to lift up those at the bottom. It would be helpful for the white community to listen to that, because that engagement from the bottom, most of the engagement of my white friends, you start at the top. The underside of our society is where you have to start finding answers. Racism last week was in a people who felt that it was not just their election stolen, but their nation was stolen. And how dare people of color help to win an election of someone who was not necessarily going to kowtow to their worst demons. And then finally, the grace today, I think, is in what Eugene and others have said, is that getting back to basics. It's like, choose this day who you will serve. But as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord. That every one of us has that decision to make. Will I serve my political party? Will I serve my whiteness, my Blackness, my Asian, Hispanic, or Native American culture? Will I serve my money, my wealth, my other status IDs? Or will I serve the God of all creation? That's the question that we have to deal with. And the grace of God always calls us back to that. We may be at a point now where there's no other place to go. Sometimes we get to this place where we run out of quick answers. There's no quick unity. Adam talked about it. There's some courageous relationships, some relationships across some barriers that we're going to have to start engaging in to get back to the middle.
Thank you. Eugene, I would like to turn to you with a way to get specific about some of the challenges Barbara and others talked about. First of all, people may have heard you're the new president of Bread for the World. I have a certain bias in taking delight in that. I was until recently chair of the board of Bread for the World, and played a small role in persuading a great pastor and preacher from Seattle, Washington, to come to work to lead Bread for the World, succeed the great leader of Reverend David Beckman. And I think I may have told you part of the reason I was intrigued by you, you had the best title of a book that I've seen in a long time. It was Thou Shalt Not Be a Jerk, A Christian Guide to Engaging Politics. How do we, at a moment of crisis, stand up for principle and not be a jerk? And the second question, Bread for the World's nonpartisan. Bread for the World is effective, working with Barbara and Adam and the Catholic bishops. The Circle of Protection has made a lot of difference. How do we make a difference on the core mission of Bread, hunger and poverty? I read yesterday where the Biden transition team is considering strengthening the earned income tax credit and the children's tax credit, which would be a lifeline for people in poverty. How do we stand for principle and not be a jerk? How do we make overcoming poverty and hunger a national priority and a moral imperative with the new administration and Congress?
Thanks, John. Great questions, and they're hard questions, and they require lots of time for us to reflect on. Even beyond this conversation, I think it's the consistent dialogue that we need to be having, that we're not drinking the Kool-Aid of our social media times where everything feels so heightened and there's such energy and vitriol and toxicity. But I would like to begin by first acknowledging that, yes, politics matter. But for us as followers of Christ, it is not the ultimate answer to all things. Politics has its place because it informs policies that impact people, oftentimes people that are marginalized or overseen. So we have to acknowledge that it matters, but we have to also acknowledge that if we're not careful, it may grow to become the idolatry of our days. So we have to have things into perspective. That really helps. A couple other things that we can do to not be a jerk, if you will, is that we have to be truth tellers. And yes, we can say it in a spirit of love and grace, but we have to tell the truth. And as Christians and as Christian leaders, people that are pastors or influentials or journalists, if we're not committed to truth, when we have scripture that tells us that the truth will set us free, then we are in very, very precarious situations. In some ways, this is why we're in such difficult times, because we have such alternative understanding of what truth is. What we witnessed last week is not just the First Amendment rights of protest. We saw so much more. We saw idolatry. We saw white supremacy. We saw this, and we have to speak the truth. It's also really important that as we engage this, we know that there's going to be people who have differing opinions. And in any healthy democracy, we have to acknowledge that. But at the same time, as Barbara mentioned earlier, we have to be careful not to dehumanize those that we disagree with. But sometimes in our self-righteousness, we can do it and not know it. And we become the very things that we criticize in others. So I truly believe that we can uphold our convictions, say it with great courage and bravery and truth-telling, but still acknowledge again that it is very, very dangerous to dehumanize others. To your second part of the question, you're absolutely right. It's so, during these crazy tumultuous times, what often gets suppressed is suffering of everyday people that's going on. Because of COVID, because of hunger, statistics tell us, experts tell us, anywhere from about 45 to 50 million Americans right now are experiencing food insecurity in our nation. that includes anywhere to 11 to 15 million children. This is unconscionable that in our nation today that boasts itself of our wealth and our greatness, we have so many of our younger neighbors that are experiencing hunger right now. One of the phrases that we use at Bread for the World that I think is really important is hunger is not a partisan issue. And so we need to plead to our nation's leaders, to our church leaders, to our civic citizens to say that if there's anything that we have to be working on together, it's issues like we have to be against racism together. We have to be against misogyny together. We have to be against these core things like core conviction that every single human being deserves the right to food. There's so much that I can say, but for the time being, I'll stop right there.
That's powerful. And in being against those things, we have to be for other things. And what several of us on this call worked on is how do we save the safety net? How do we strengthen the lifelines for people in poverty? And that's why proposals that are beginning to be circulated to build on the earned income credit and the children's credit are signs of hope, a little bit of grace, maybe policy grace, Barbara. Kathleen, let me turn to you. You and I are Catholics. Barbara's community was mostly united in this election. We were not. There are people today looking forward to the inauguration of the second Catholic president with great pride and are committed to President Biden because of his empathy or his positions. There are others who are really disappointed and frankly are opposed some of the positions he took. For example, he says he would support federal funding of abortion, which has been a consistent policy in our country. Some of us feel a little bit of both, a little bit of pride and a little bit of concern. Of the people in the Catholic community, you hold together those tensions better than most. You have been working for years in the Archdiocese of Los Angeles, trying to get people to support both life and dignity. You run this wonderful festival, One Life LA. How do we, with integrity, stand up for our principles when they sometimes conflict with each other and sometimes we deal with politicians where one day we're with them, the other day we're opposed? How do we do that with integrity, with civility, in a principled fashion? You've been doing that all the time.
John, that's the question of our day, isn't it? You're absolutely right to say that the Catholic community was and continues to be incredibly divided over this election. So much so that we've seen in our parishes, we've seen in our Catholic families, we've seen even in our bishop's conference, a lot of division. And I think the division needs to find healing at some point, but it's going to take some time to do that. And I think it's going to take some really important steps. So first of all, as has been said, I think it's very, very important to recognize that politics is important, but it's not our end. Our end is salvation. Our end is to be saints and to help other people be saints and get to heaven. Our end is to bring the gospel message and to create, as Pope Francis says, a culture of care here on earth to help those on the margins, to help the least ones, to help our brothers and sisters. And so I think very much we can put our faith in the forefront. And if we, those of us who are trying to create unity, make a conscious effort to be Catholic first, prior to being partisan, I think that goes a long way. But I will say that this present moment brings with it a lot of questions and concerns. We actually have the second Catholic president, or about to be the second Catholic president ever. And what does that say to us as Catholics? And what does that say, I think, to our ability to work with him in a particular way? Now, we've done this in California. We have a lot of Catholic legislators, most of whom are Democrats. We talk about this all the time. But at the national level, this is something new. And I think one thing we can all agree on is the worst possible thing would be if the next 4 years President-elect Biden and the U.S. Bishops Conference were at war with each other. I don't think anybody wants to see that. I don't think that would serve our church. I don't think that would serve our country. I don't think that would serve our people. I don't think that's what President-elect Biden would want. And so I think it's important that we recognize that he and we are in opposition on some very fundamental and important issues. I think it's time that we really implore him, please, President-elect Biden, do not make abortion the center of your presidency. Do not make abortion expansion the center of a presidency, because that will cause the Catholic bishops to have to double down and have to really say, we can't do anything other than that. That's central to who we are, is that understanding of the right to life and the dignity and the beauty of every single human life. And I think that President-elect Biden would agree with us in many aspects. So what we hope is, let's look beyond that. Let's see what we can do together. And I think together we can be so powerful. And I think it would be a beautiful, beautiful thing to be able to say, we're probably not going to change his mind on abortion. I think we can hope for that and pray for that and work for that. But at the end of the day, I don't think that's going to happen. But if he doesn't double down on that, we can work together on the things that are so important to us. What could we do on homelessness? What could we do on foster care? What could we do on helping women and children and families in need with paid family leave and low cost daycare? And how can we get inner city kids in our Catholic schools to get the best possible education and a way out of poverty? What could we do together on all of these topics? And I think that's something for us to examine. And I think the best way to do that is to understand, not to vilify our opponents, but to see them as children of God as we are, and to lead with love.
There will be lots of thoughts and comments on that. Adam, I want you to lean a little forward because I'm going to ask you some hard questions. You're a pro. You're new to your position as president of Sojourners, succeeding our friend and leader and ally, Jim Wallace. But you have been working in this world for a long time at the World Bank, at World Vision, at Sojourners before this. How do we make sure in the middle of this crisis, with a new administration coming, that our priorities that we hold in common, overcoming racism, lifting up the poor, dealing with criminal justice, dealing with care for creation that you mentioned, are in fact the priorities of this administration and a new Congress? While both houses are Democratic, the margins are really narrow. How does the Christian community in all its diversity, and we've heard that today, how do we stand up so we're not cheerleaders for an administration, chaplains, apologists, nor part of the resistance? How do we affirm and hold accountable our leaders?
Thanks, John. Yeah, you saved me the softball at the end. Great question. So we all know that Monday is Dr. Martin Luther King holiday. And it's a day of remembrance of the life and legacy of Dr. King. It's also a day, I think, where we have to do some hard reflection. I appreciate Kathleen's mention of this, some self-examination about where we've come out of as a country, but also what are we moving toward? Dr. King once said in a sermon that the church at its best is not called to be the master or the servant of the state, but to be the conscience of the state. And I actually think we could even broaden it beyond the Christian faith. I think we could replace church with mosque or synagogue or other religious institutions. But in our faith tradition, we are truly called to be the conscience. And I think the right way for us to be engaging with the new Biden administration is for us to have what I call critical and courageous engagement. We need to engage. We need to support and celebrate when they do things right. And we need to be willing and able to criticize when they fall short, or when they lack imagination, or where they don't act on the courage of their convictions. It is possible to be both pastoral with members of Congress and to be prophetic. And sometimes, yes, they're in a healthy tension with each other, and you have to have the discernment to know when to be more prophetic and when to be more pastoral. But I think we make a mistake if we are only one or the other. We also make the mistake of the religious right movement if we try to take over a political party or become too aligned with a political party, because in the process, we become co-opted by that political party. In many respects, I think the religious right became co-opted by Trumpism, not just the Republican Party, but literally by Trump himself. And they may have thought that they were forming this Faustian bargain, but ultimately ended up forfeiting a great deal of their soul, in essence. And so, you know, one of the documents I've learned a lot from, and John is very familiar with this one, is faithful citizenship. It's an engagement document the Catholic Church developed many years ago, and they talk about these principles of being engaged but never used, political but not partisan, principled and not ideological. And I don't have time to unpack them all, but I think they provide a really good moral compass for how we engage in politics. Another quick point I want to make is that, building on what Kathleen said, I also hope that the new administration doesn't double down on abortion. At the same time, though, you know, let's expand our imagination about what we can do to work together, bridging the pro-choice and pro-life divide so that we can radically reduce the number of unwanted pregnancies or abortions in this country. We know the very things that Kathleen named, like improving our adoption system and increasing access to healthcare, particularly to low-income women, by increasing economic opportunity and so much more, it is proven to reduce the number of abortions in this nation. And so, you know, let's try, hopefully we can kind of get rid of it being an issue that is a political football and really try to find some of that common ground, as difficult and as challenging as that may be. The last point that I want to pick up on really briefly is a point that Barbara made, Dr. Skinner made. Racism and white supremacy have disfigured American democracy for the very beginning of our nation. In some ways, you could argue that our democracy is only 55 years old. Since the passage of the Voting Rights Act in 1965, the crowning achievement of the Civil Rights Movement extended voting rights to all Americans, particularly to Black Americans, that have been ruthlessly denied that right. That is when kind of our democracy began, in one sense. And one of the things that I took for granted is that my generation, Generation X, would still have to be fighting that fight. That 55 years later, we would still see an assault on the right to vote, which Congressman John Lewis understood as a sacred right and as the most powerful nonviolent tool in a democracy. And so the big lie that not only Trump told, but so many of his enablers told, that this election was fraudulent and stolen, is what helped lead to the armed insurrection last week. You can't separate the two. And so for us to move forward, and for all the agenda items that John just named, I do think that we have to restore a greater embrace of truth in our democracy. We've got to get rid of this kind of post-truth moment that we've been in. And we have to be willing to overcome, you know, that kind of founding lie of our nation that some people are worth more than others, and that some Americans are more American than other. Clearly, that is going to be a long road, but I'm actually pretty hopeful. And the last thing I'll just say really quickly is that the other thing that happened the same day the Capitol was taken over by armed insurrectionists is that the first African-American senator was elected from a southern state in the state of Georgia. It just happens to be the pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church, the church I joined in 1994 when I began at Emory University. And I think there's some really powerful historical symmetry in that, some divine symmetry maybe even, that in the same moment that we had one of the biggest attacks on our democracy, you also saw a southern state elect a Black preacher that I think is in this tradition of the prophetic witness of the church that is so transformational.
That's powerful. I would point out it's not the same, but to have a Black preacher quoting a Catholic document on a webcast is a pretty big deal too. We have just a whole bunch of really good prophetic pastoral questions. Let me lay out three general questions and then ask you to jump in. One, several people have said, Jerry, first of all, they want to thank the journalists for their courage and for their skill and for being there. We would not know what had happened. We would not know enough about this election. So to you and your colleagues, and secondly, how come we don't know more about what happened? How come we don't, people have said that maybe there was complicity on the part of the police or on the part of members of Congress or whatever. Journalists were there and discovered a lot. What more do we need to know about this? So that's one question, and that's for Jerry. For the rest of the panel, two other themes. One is pastoral. My pastor never even acknowledged that this was going on. My pastor acts like Biden didn't win the election. My pastor talks about politics too much. My parish is divided. How do we build up unity? How do we get the bishops, in one case, our religious leaders, to stand for truth, but also to build bridges? And then the second goes back to the fundamentals. We have to acknowledge where white supremacy fits in all this. And what is the responsibility of white Christians to deal with white supremacy that has shaped our reality? We've had lots of statements on racism. Hopefully we're getting more serious, but it's not just our public life that is shaped by racism. It's our ecclesial life, and sadly, even our Christian life. So what more do we need to know? Thanks to the journalists. What are the pastoral ways to tell the truth and to build bridges? And thirdly, how do we confront white supremacy and deal with the way racism makes all this worse? The election, COVID, the economy. Jerry, why don't you begin while the others gather their thoughts?
Sure, of course. And I'll try to be brief. But first of all, to say thank you for the sentiment. It's much appreciated. And, you know, I have a colleague who was assaulted covering a street unrest earlier this year, and then more recently covered a Proud Boys march and came down with COVID-19. So there are risks out there. And it's kind of what you do. It's part of the territory. I think the role that we play, I'd like to think, is never more important than at a time like this week. In terms of why don't we know more? I mean, in the same way the Capitol Police were outmanned, so were the journalists, to be honest. I mean, we had reporters there who thought they were covering a parliamentary procedure, and it turns out they were covering a mob attack on the Capitol, and nobody was quite prepared. They were pushed off to the side and under threat, the same as everybody else. So this was a sprawling attack on the Capitol. And this is getting to the bottom of it is partly a journalistic task, but it's really more than anything else going to be a law enforcement task. So I think that the journalists there did an awful lot, and there's more to be done for sure. And mostly, I think, final thought, what we need to know more than anything else are the origins of the event. I think we know plenty more than we did a week ago about what actually happened. I think we know not nearly enough yet about why it happened.
John, I wanted to, first of all, I do want to thank Jerry, because I can't even imagine for the last 4 years how much more difficult it would have been had we not gotten daily information from very brave journalists. So I really want to thank you for that as well. One of the problems of moving from a culture, I'm a football fan, and when a losing team like the Jets, okay, when a losing team like Jacksonville, when they have a long series of losses and they bring in a new coach, what they need to know is how do you change the culture, okay? And they'll tell you a couple things that have to happen. One is that you have to move toward something and not away from something. No, we're moving. So imagine if we said that racism is sin, and therefore we need a radical, reimagining of what it means to be a beloved community. And we want to make that the goal. We're moving towards something, reimagining what we the people would look like. In other words, We're reacting against things all the time, but we're seldom moving toward something. Therefore, Cleveland Browns, we're in the playoff. Okay. So, who knew? So that's one issue. Two is that it's not enough to say I'm not a racist. The issue is, are you engage in an anti-racist agenda? If racism is real, that's the sin. Let's think about it in Christian term. When we think about other sins, okay, we think about, how do we educate, preach, teach, develop liturgies, all of that around, getting people to move towards salvation and a Christian life. How do you move toward a country where they're not systems that value one people? This is blasphemy, because it basically says that God lied. It's not true in Genesis that God created us in his image and likeness, because everything about America is just the opposite. So I think Eugene is so right. We have to lament and repent. And I don't mean white people. I mean collectively. We need to repent and say that, God, we are sorry that we are living in a way that you don't matter except on Sunday. And then finally, I would say that we need to find a way to think about what would a teaching and training. I'm a toolkit fiend. What would teaching and training look like to move the church back toward the teaching of Jesus? In other words, we might need to talk about evangelizing the church so that in the ways of Jesus, so that we get back to that. Politics is never going to save us. And I'm as involved as anyone. The reason I didn't endorse Joe Biden, even though I'm a Democrat, is that I don't want to be where I was with Obama. I don't want to be in the room. I want to be on the outside reflecting and, engaging if necessary, not the opposition, but free to say what I need to say. So a radical reimagining of the beloved community, what would that look like? Agreeing that systemic racism is sin, and then thinking together about how would we develop the tools for changing the culture, move towards something and not just away from something.
Thank you, Barbara. You've given a great summation of your perspective. I would add, each of our panelists, we're reaching the end here. Remember the question as you wrap up, white supremacy, how do we take it on? And secondly, the pastoral dimensions. How do you tell the truth? And how do you build bridges at the same time? Why don't I go to Kathleen next, and then Adam, and have Eugene take us out.
Great. So I think we've had a lot of examples here today. We've talked about racism. We've talked about poverty. We've talked about abortion. I think it's important for us to remember that these are not partisan issues at their core. They're human issues. And so that pastoral piece is really going back to the evangelization, remembering who we are, as children of God, and who we are as all brothers and sisters. Do we treat each other like brothers and sisters? Do we love first? That includes our elected officials. Do we go to them in humility and say, I am willing to make some changes, and I'm asking you to make some changes so that we can put those people first who are most in need? I think that's going to help us a lot.
Yeah, thank you. I love being a part of this conversation. Wish we could go on for many more hours. I love what Dr. Skinner just said, a radical reimagining the beloved community. She knows that, and I'm not saying this to make a plug for my future book, but I just finished a book focused on the beloved community. It's entitled A More Perfect Union, A New Vision for Building Beloved Community. And part of the premise of the book is that one of the reasons why we have been so severely divided and polarized as a nation is not only that we have such conflicting understandings of our own history, how we've gotten to where we are, but we also have such conflicting understandings or visions of where we want to go. And I'm not naive to believe that every American is going to unite around the exact same moral vision, but I do have the audacity to believe that a recast, reimagined vision of the beloved community would actually unite the vast, vast majority of Americans, because it would tap into a lot of our shared civic and religious ideals. And so in the last section of my book, I talk about the Beatitudes of the beloved community, which in my mind include Imago Dei. It includes a radical commitment to welcome, particularly the other and the stranger. It includes what I call Ubuntu interdependence. It includes dignity for all. It includes a number of things along those lines. As a pastoral piece, I think we've got to find ways to help. And of course, things aren't divided this neatly, but just to, for the sake of argument, one camp of churches that are apolitical that need to be convinced that there's a danger in being apolitical, and it's actually inconsistent with the gospel. And those that are overly political, that have overly politicized the gospel, and we have to convince them that they need to center the gospel and not their politics. And I'll just end with one thing that my pastor does very effectively, Reverend Howard John Wesley. When he is preaching a sermon that is going to be potentially controversial, he says at the beginning, "My job as your pastor is not to convince you to think the exact same way that I think, particularly about politics. My job is to get you to think more critically and theologically about the very things that impact the human condition and impact your faith." And that line alone, I think, could be very beneficial to many pastors on both sides of that, of those extremes.
Eugene, bring us home.
Well, again, thank you for hosting and for convening this gathering. Let me make a quick case for why it's possible for someone to leave their church around politics and why someone should stay. I think there's a case for someone to leave because leaving your church does not mean that you're leaving your faith. If there is toxicity, if there is violence, if there is a consistent unwillingness to tell truth, as much as it pains me, I think it is fair for someone to consider making a move to leave their respective church. Now, here's a case for why we should stay. Because we're called not to attend an event, we're called to a community. We're called to relationships. We're called into community during high seasons and low seasons. It's the symbol of communion that gives me great inspiration. As a pastor of a church, every single Sunday for 20 years, we invited people and we celebrated the sacrament of communion. And in doing so, we told people that we don't have a line on the right that serves juice for our conservatives. We don't have a line on the left that serves wine for our progressives. And we didn't have a line in the middle that served gluten-free option for our independents. There's something powerful about the table inviting all people unto Christ. And so I think this is part of that new imagination, which isn't new, but an imagination that goes back to the radical nature of the gospel. One last thing that I'll just share. On Monday, we will be celebrating Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And the cynic in me says, I'm bracing myself for the barrage of quotes on social media. And we have to remind ourselves again, let's not simply reduce him or the gospel to merely annual quotes on social media. What does it mean for us to truly live out, to embody the dream? To seek first the kingdom of God, to confront evil, to be a truth teller, to seek justice, to advocate for the poor and hungry, to pursue reconciliation, to love your neighbors, and even to forgive your enemies.
I want to thank our panelists very much. It seems to me what we have here is a crisis of faith, hope, and love. And I think what we've had today are examples of faith, hope, and love. I would invite you to consider joining us on Thursday, February 4th, for a gathering, a dialogue on Black women and criminal injustice, missing voices in the conversation. Been a lot of focus on criminal justice, Black Lives Matter. Black women's lives and voices matter, and we're going to focus on that. The spring will bring many more, Francis Factor, the poverty issue, the vocation of a journalist. But at this moment, at this time, we receive some truth, some grace, some challenge from these leaders. And join me in thanking them. And I thank you for joining us. Have a good afternoon.